Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I'd like to continue our discussion of the origins of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict by looking at the second half century in this very complex topic, specifically moving from the period of the establishment of the State of Israel in 1948 through the Oslo Accords of 1993. I've subtitled this Towards the Two-State Solution because that was one of the most important elements of this period. In this discussion, I'm going to try and focus my comments primarily on the ways in which both Israelis and Palestinians saw the major historical events and how they shaped the path towards some kind of peace. I will not be devoting attention to every single element of this history because it's overwhelming for a very short presentation, but hopefully these elements that I present will be cogent and coherent and will help to provide some background to understanding what we are to make of the current crisis today. History and her fraternal twin sister memory are closely interrelated. History affects memory, memory then turns around and affects history. A simplistic view of history is one in which we say, you know, just tell me what exactly happened and when. We don't realize that every time we tell something about history, we tell it from a particular perspective. If you consider, for example, two people standing at very different points of an intersection witnessing a traffic accident, they'll both see very different things because of the place in which they're situated as that accident happens. So when we look at something far more complicated than a simple fender bender, the 100-year-long conflict between Israelis and Palestinians, how much more so is it crucial to understand exactly where we were standing and what kind of perspective we have. In this context, let me share a little bit about my own background and how I come to this history, and then specifically the sources that I have been researching specifically for this video. So I was born, obviously, to a Jewish family in the 1960s in Canada, and I was raised on a fairly steady diet of what we might call the heroic school of Israeli historiography, which basically presents materials in a way that describes the struggle of the young Israeli nation in a very positive light, obviously, and displays the behavior of the enemies of the State of Israel in a very negative light. To be understood, it's a national historiography that aims to create an affinity for the State of Israel, for the ideals of Zionism, and so on. And I believe that the skeletal structure of that historiographic model is basically sound. However, as memory and history interact, and specifically as people go back to the archival sources and revisit more details and different perspectives on those same events, some of those historical evaluations have to be re-evaluated. And so I'm going to rely for this presentation on much of my prior research based in that heroic school, but also on newer research that I think qualifies that material significantly. First of all, I'm going to rely on a lot of the excellent work done by Professor Benny Morris of Ben-Gurion University. He is a member of what's sometimes called the New Historian School in Israel that has basically done the hard work of going back to the archives and asking some of the very difficult questions about those controversial elements that we'll look at briefly in this video. His recent book, Righteous Victims, A History of the Zionist-Arab Conflict, 1881 to 2001, is sometimes very difficult reading, and there are definitely some elements there that I can see would provoke controversy. I've also relied, obviously, on a Palestinian perspective, Professor Rashid Khalidi from Columbia University, who is the author of The Hundred Years' War on Palestine, A History of Settler Colonialism and Resistance, 1917 to 2017. And his perspective, like Professor Morris's, is definitely partisan. But what I think is very useful about both of them is that despite their very deeply involved and cherished beliefs about the nature of the trajectory of this conflict, they are both very quite self-critical and are willing to look at their own movements and to determine what went wrong within Zionism or within the Palestinian movement. And so with those caveats, let me present to you how I see the major developments of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict so we can have a better handle on understanding what's happening today and hopefully make some progress towards a rational dialogue and at some point a lasting peace. For Israelis and Palestinians, the original sin was certainly the period that the Palestinians call the Nakba and Israelis call the War of Independence. The Nakba, or catastrophe, refers to the forced displacement of a large number, something like 700,000 plus refugees, Arab refugees, Palestinian refugees, from what would be later Israeli territory and moving them off into various refugee camps and into diaspora. The way in which the heroic historiography of Israel portrays this, it's more like a voluntary flight, sometimes with more venal motivations, but a closer look at the archival records indicate that while there was no organized plan to displace these refugees, it was definitely something which was not unwelcome to the young state for reasons that I think should be obvious. If you have a look at this map here, this is from Professor Morris's book. You can see the hatched lines represent the territory held by Israel on May 15th, 1948, which was, you know, when they declared independence. It is smaller than the territory that was allotted to them by the 1947 partition plan, but this is where they actually existed in the land of Israel with some control at the time. They were then invaded by several armies, by Egypt, Jordan, Iraq, and by Syria. And amazingly, they were able to hold them off, and not only that, to actually expand the territory a little bit. Now, it is a remarkable military achievement. As Professor Kramer put it in her last book, though, it's not exactly a David versus Goliath kind of battle. It was more like David versus many Davids because the Arab armies suffered from a lot of deficiencies. But if you look at the challenges that the young Israeli state faced, particularly looking at that small strip of land extending from the coast to Jerusalem, you know, this is a very indefensible kind of territory. And so this plan Dalit, which was especially focused on consolidating territories and roadways in particular to be able to access important Jewish settlements, was crucial. Beginning from the date that the Israelis declared statehood to the period when the British actually evacuated and then the full-on war, there are a lot of hostilities which occasionally involved some horrific atrocities, such as that of Deir Yassin, which spread fear throughout the Palestinian population that the Israelis would be attacking them. And they could point to a few examples where, in fact, that had happened. And for the Haganah, the proto-army of the State of Israel, later transformed into the Israel Defense Forces, or IDF, they had no reason to stop Arabs from fleeing because they saw that as the Palestinians left their homes, they were freeing up more territory to allow them to achieve their objectives of securing the roads and a more defensible set of borders. Now, what that means for the displaced Palestinians is that many of them, hundreds of thousands, were displaced into camps. And as you can see from this map, refugee camps were set up throughout the region in the Gaza Strip, in neighboring Jordan, which of course from 1949 till 1967 also controlled the West Bank, in Syria, and in Lebanon. In terms of the numbers, looking at it from the early 21st century, there were about 5.5 million people who are registered with the United Nations as being refugees or descendants of refugees. Those are the children, obviously, of the original 700,000 odd refugees. And about 1.5 million of them are still in the camps. About 370,000 in Jordan, 200,000 in the West Bank, 100,000 in Syria, 200,000 in Lebanon, and 700,000 in Gaza. It is worthy of note that most of the descendants of those original refugees have made lives for themselves in a Palestinian diaspora. But still, that massive number of 1.5 million people living in refugee camps throughout the region is deeply troubling and, of course, is a constant reminder of how important this problem is and how it must be solved. By 1949, the armistice lines had created something which would later be known as the Green Line, the borders of Israel, even if the states surrounding it did not recognize its official existence. Israel continued to deal with infiltrations, from neighboring countries, from Egypt in particular, and there were conflicts like the 1956 Sinai War that were very relevant for many other reasons, but I want to focus on the 1967 Six-Day War because that is especially crucial from the Palestinian perspective. If you have a look at this map here, in June of 1967, Israel looked like the map on the left, and you can see it, Gaza was then part of Egypt, and the West Bank was part of Jordan. Israel then fought a war primarily with Egypt, but also with Jordan and with Syria as well. And amazingly, over the course of a very brief period of time, 6 days, and specifically through establishing air superiority early on, Israel was able to actually expand its territory dramatically. It was rather a surprising victory for everyone involved, and Israel had to decide what it was going to do with these territories. And this is extremely important, so let me slow down a little bit. They decided to annex two parts of the region. Annex meaning they took those parts and they made them permanently part of the state of Israel, never to be returned in any future peace deal. Specifically, the eastern part of Jerusalem. Jerusalem had been a divided city since 1949, and actually the holiest site of Jewish geography, the Temple Mount, was located on the Jordanian side. Since Jerusalem is the historic capital of the Jewish people, East Jerusalem was annexed outright and made part of the State of Israel proper. This also happened in the north, in the Golan Heights, where you have a mountainous region, and whoever commands the heights either looks down onto the Galilee or looks down onto Damascus. And given that it had great strategic value and not a huge local population, it was easy for the Israelis to annex that territory as well. However, the West Bank, with its large Palestinian population, posed a much greater threat because annexing the territory would involve giving all those Arabs citizenship. And that would deeply upset the demographic balance that Israel must maintain if it is to remain a Jewish state. And let us recall that Israel is striving really for two basic goals. One, to establish a Jewish state, a country that is free for Jewish immigration, that Jews can flee there if they are persecuted elsewhere. And secondly, it wants to establish a democratic state. It wants the political basis of Israel to be essentially one person, one vote. About 20% of Israel's population is not Jewish, primarily Palestinian Muslims, also Palestinian Christians, also Druze and Baha'i and many other peoples. And 20% is a sizable minority, but it still retains the basic Jewish character of the state. If citizenship were extended to all of these people in the West Bank and also in Gaza, that would seriously threaten the demographic balance of Israel as a Jewish state and simply could not be countenanced. So the West Bank and Gaza and the largely uninhabited Sinai Peninsula was simply occupied. These territories were administered by Israel, controlled by Israel, but the general thinking was that they would be exchanged for some kind of peace deal. Not all Israelis felt that way. Some said that peace should be exchanged for peace and the territory should remain within Israel, but by and large, the dominant opinion was that these territories would be given back. And in fact, this is what happened to Sinai, as we'll discuss in a minute. But here's a really important moment for the Palestinians. This document is Resolution 242, which was issued a few months after the conclusion of the Six-Day War. And it's really important for two main reasons. The first is something that you see in item number one, Roman number one, which refers to the basis of a peace, a just and lasting peace, as the withdrawal of Israel armed forces from territories occupied in the recent conflict, meaning in the Six-Day War. And what this implicitly said was that there would be a just and lasting peace going back to the Green Line boundaries of 1949, that if Israel were to give up these territories that it conquered, then in fact a just and lasting peace could be achieved. This is actually a big plus for Israel in many ways, because the surrounding Arab states did not recognize the 1949 boundaries as a permanent and lasting peace. They regarded it as a kind of larger ceasefire, an armistice for the time being. So that was a big win for Israel in one sense. And note, by the way, I've included the French, which is also the official version, but the French version has a very key small distinction. It includes the phrase des territoires, as opposed to simply territories, which is much more demanding that all of those territories had to be returned, whereas in the English version, it only implies that at least some of the territories, from territories, not from the territories. The other thing which is hugely important about this document is something which is not written, and that is the word Palestinian. This entire document reflects a relationship between the state of Israel, now recognized with boundaries of 1949, and its neighbor nation states. This was not something that affected the Palestinians, according to the document. It was something that affected Jordan, Egypt, and Syria in particular, and peace would be made between those players, not involving the Palestinians. And this, I think, is perhaps one of the most important drivers of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict from the beginning up until the present day. And that is that the Israelis failed to adequately understand the Palestinians, and the Palestinians failed to adequately understand the Israelis. Let me just take a very brief moment to speak about that. In terms of the Palestinian misunderstanding of the Israelis, they failed to grasp just how desperate this people was after the Holocaust. Palestinians through the 1960s, and many pro-Palestinian enthusiasts today, seem to take it for granted that Israeli Jews would be prepared to accept to live as kind of like, you know, guests within a generous, benign Islamic host society. And that's simply not valid for Jews after the Holocaust. Jews must have a refuge. They must have a home. The earth is so big. Jews demand a small portion for themselves, and they believe that it is totally within their moral right to demand it, especially in their ancestral home. For their part, the Israelis misunderstand that the Palestinian national cause, although it awakened much later than many other nationalities, it nevertheless is very real and profound. This is a society that at the beginning of the 20th century was still quite primitive in terms of having very low levels of literacy and education and so on. And most of their national expressions were of loyalty to region and perhaps to clan, to religion, but they regarded themselves as part of a larger pan-Arabic society. Those things are all very true. But by discounting the Palestinian drive for self-determination, which would really awaken in the second half of the 20th century, by never taking those concerns seriously, Israelis tended to miss the boat and to disrespect the Palestinians in ways that would be incredibly tragic. And this Resolution 242 is perhaps the pinnacle of that statement coming from the United Nations that completely ignores Palestinian considerations. Now, we would see this come to fruition in this very jovial photograph here that shows the Egyptian leader Anwar Sadat on the left, the American President Jimmy Carter in the center, and the Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin, who had faced off against each other in the 1973 war, launched by Egypt in particular. But the reason why these three men are smiling here is because after that war was fought and Egypt was able to retain some pride, and after demonstrating that Egypt could inflict damage on Israel, he was able to call up Menachem Begin and effect a peace treaty. In the late 1970s, Israel, with some significant internal controversy, gave the entire Sinai Peninsula back to Egypt, but Egypt was unwilling to take back the Gaza Strip with its high concentration of restive Palestinians, many of whom showed an affinity for the Muslim Brotherhood, an organization which later would spawn Hamas, and Egypt felt that they were simply too destabilizing an element to bring into their polity. Anwar Sadat's vision of peace in the Middle East came to fruition. And although the relationship between Israel and Egypt has not been decidedly warm, it has nevertheless maintained peaceful relations since the 1980s. But Anwar Sadat himself would pay for this with his life, as some of his own bodyguard, incensed with the idea that he would make peace, turned on him and shot him dead. The turning point for the Palestinian movement was undoubtedly the establishment of the Palestine Liberation Organization led by Yasser Arafat. This was to be the focal point of Palestinian national efforts, and although they had to elbow their way to the table, not only at the United Nations and elsewhere, but even among other Arab allies, nevertheless, they took the lead in articulating what they wanted for themselves, rather than allowing the Arab states in the region to dictate what would be the fate of the Palestinians. They wrote a national charter in 1964 that was thoroughly unrealistic, laying out essentially a one-state Palestinian vision of the land of Israel, where only those Jews and their descendants who had lived in the territory before the Balfour Declaration in 1917 would have any rights. And furthermore, that armed struggle was the only way to liberate Palestine. This notion of a one-state solution combined with violence to achieve that end was thoroughly unacceptable to the Israelis. The PLO then sought to gain attention for its cause through some very dramatic terrorist activities throughout Europe and the Middle East, which included things like airplane hijackings in particular, the massacre of the Israeli Olympic athletes at Munich, and many other elements. It is important to note that in this brief video, I'm speaking about the PLO generally, but we should understand that it is essentially an umbrella organization, and there are many different factions that come together under this umbrella, and a more nuanced look at the various groups would say a lot more about the internal debate over the value of these kinds of activities. But we can say in general that the PLO, under Arafat's leadership, at this time failed to grasp some very important emerging realities about the future of their national movement. First of all, they completely misunderstood the importance of public opinion in Europe and especially in America, where the Israelis had far greater experience with the media environment, with the culture, they had developed many connections and so on, and the PLO was not going to win their propaganda war through terrorism. In fact, it was just burying them further and sidelining the movement as being one associated with criminality and violence. Secondly, the PLO failed to realize that their conduct and even their mere presence in states bordering Israel made them increasingly unwelcome. Jordan, for example, which was one of the friendliest states to the Palestinians, granting them citizenship, for example, and in fact the majority of the Jordanian population is of Palestinian extraction, they found that they had to expel Arafat and the PLO after an uprising in September 1970 that was aimed at overthrowing the monarchy there. Same sort of thing happened in Lebanon and elsewhere, and by the time you get to the 1980s, the PLO is basically out of the region. It has no direct border contact with the State of Israel, and it's basically Arafat and others are hiding out in Tunis in North Africa. Furthermore, Arafat made a few key missteps at this point. He backed, for example, Iraq against Kuwait when Iraq invaded, leading to a much larger invasion of Iraq in 1991. And much of the PLO was bankrolled by the Soviet Union, which saw it as a useful proxy in its battle against the United States in the Cold War. And as the Soviet Union began to go through its slow train wreck of self-destruction, it became clear that the PLO was going to lose more and more power. Ultimately, by the time you get to the early 1990s, the PLO has figured this out. They amended their charter significantly in favor of the kind of things that Israel would want to see, including the acceptance of Resolution 242 with at least the 1949 boundaries for Israel, and secondly, abandoning the notion that armed struggle is the only way to liberate Palestine. And this is when we can start talking seriously about a two-state solution. That is the idea of Israel as a Jewish state and Palestine as an eventual Palestinian state in the same region in one form or another. It is unlikely, however, that even this two-state model would have received any traction were it not for the First Intifada that it broke out in December of 1987. The term Intifada in Arabic refers to a kind of like an uprising, a general revolt that is kind of like a spontaneous grassroots movement, and that was a fair description of what began to happen. Arafat, although the titular head of the PLO, was severely weakened off in his hideout in Tunis. Many of his allies had been co-opted by their states or assassinated by Israel, and he simply had lost a lot of power, although he still had a symbolic kind of role to play as the figurehead of the Palestinian movement. What happened in December 1987 is that the Palestinians themselves in Gaza and the West Bank began to rise up spontaneously on their own. And the character of their uprising was rather different than anything they had done before. The First Intifada was now characterized by widespread terrorism in the sense of things that would later become much more associated with the Second Intifada, blowing up of buses and pizza shops and things like that. It was rather a kind of a symbolic attack on the IDF, as we see in this iconic photograph of a young Palestinian boy throwing a rock at this massive Israeli tank. The Palestinians, through a very deft use of the large number of foreign journalists who were frequently on the ground in Israel, were able to take their message to the world in a very different way and actually inverted the David versus Goliath model that had frequently applied to the Israelis in the earlier heroic historiography. Now the Palestinians adopted that mantle of the young David and Israel as the oppressor. The Palestinians in this First Intifada were able to really draw attention to the multiple humiliations that were associated with living in a second-class status in the West Bank and in Gaza, such as moving through slow checkpoints, which were designed by the Israelis to allow the large number of West Bank and Gaza residents who worked in the State of Israel to proceed into Israel proper and to their jobs, and to not allow people who are going to be engaged in terrorism in Israel. So for the Israelis, these security checkpoints were precisely what they sound like, but for Palestinians, they were a daily humiliation. Furthermore, and there were a significant number of Israelis who felt that they should not be giving territory back to any other Arab population, and either for economic or ideological reasons, they were moving into these territories that were beyond the Green Line. And a significant number of Israelis, Jewish Israelis, were now living in West Bank lands, a smaller number in Gaza, and many Palestinians saw these people as the leading edge of an Israeli land grab. There was frequent conflict and violence that occurred in the West Bank as a result of the meeting of these two populations. At this point, I'd like to refer you to what we talked about at the beginning of this video about how history and memory are interrelated. The history that I studied in the context of the Six-Day War, in the context of the peace deal with Egypt, it portrayed Israel as moving forward with a righteous cause and making peace with its increasingly reasonable Arab neighbors. There's a lot to be said for this understanding of the history, and as I hope to discuss in the next video in this series, we see a lot of Arab states ultimately decide to make peace with Israel in the 21st century. So it is a model that's still quite valuable. However, if we put myself in the shoes of someone who was born, let's say 1987, when the First Intifada came out, their first encounters with Israel and what they see in the newspapers and on television and then later on the internet is shaped by the new presentation of material that the Palestinians are for the first time really bringing forward about themselves. The Second Intifada would hurt that image significantly, as we shall see, but in the period of the First Intifada, you create the roots for a new understanding of Palestine among Gen Xers and millennials. We'll talk about that shortly. When you put all of these things together, the beginning of a shift in the international narrative, the weakness of the PLO as the official leader of the Palestinian movement, and the collapse of its support from the loss of the Soviet Union, led Yitzhak Rabin, the Prime Minister of Israel, to determine that he had to make peace with Yasser Arafat. And his reasoning was, if he did not make peace with the PLO, he would ultimately have to make peace with 1,000 other Palestinian entities, because the PLO could not itself handle the fractious nature of its population. It had already lost control of much of the narrative, which was being taken over by the Palestinians living in the West Bank and Gaza. And so, much like Anwar Sadat reached out to Menachem Begin, Yitzhak Rabin reached out to Yasser Arafat. And with the assistance of the United States under Bill Clinton, shown here in this famous photograph, they were able to establish another peace treaty, the Oslo Accords, which was really the culmination of this idea of a two-state solution. I'm going to spend a lot more time talking about what that solution was and what its challenges were and are in the next video. But at this point, we have to mention that in a cruel irony of history, just as Anwar Sadat was assassinated by Muslim extremists who disagreed with his view of peace, so too was Yitzhak Rabin assassinated by a Jewish extremist who was incensed with the idea of making peace with a former terrorist. Here you see a very sad photograph, which was a copy of a Hebrew poem, The Song for Peace, which was stained with Yitzhak Rabin's own blood in the context of his assassination. So that's my discussion of the second half century of the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. I hope you found it of some value, and I hope that it provides some material for rational discussion between people of goodwill to contribute in whatever way it can to the just and lasting peace enjoyed by all the peoples of the region in prosperity and in good health. Thank you for watching.